You are listening to Making Sense with Alison Blackler. Welcome to Making Sense, and this is our 16th episode. Thank you so much for everyone who is listening in and those that send messages and requests and keeping us going, really. We are here down in the studio at Wirral Wave at Make in Hamilton Square in the heart of Birkenhead. And as ever, we've got George in the studio, who is the producer of the show. And we are also having a special guest, who is Shelley F Knight, and she is coming back as a guest because she was with us in March. But this time we are going to focus on loss, but the much wider aspects of loss. And Shelley is going to share with you some of her thoughts around loss. She is the author of a book called Good Grief, The A to Z Approach of Modern Day Grief Healing. And this is an inspirational companion of your journey through grief. But it's also a very practical book. But what is really interesting is we're talking about grief to do with anything that we've had an emotional connection with. Because it's fair to say that we're not meant to feel happy 24/7. We can have any feeling of anything every minute of every day. And we are designed to have a wide spectrum of emotions, to keep us safe, to help us learn, to help us grow. So sometimes our range of emotions can come through loss or things that have ended. So in this show, we're going to focus on that, but not necessarily just on the idea of somebody being a person that we've lost. So we're going to give some honest thoughts and experiences. So certainly Shelley will share that about managing loss. We will play her interview later in the show, but we've also got some great tunes from Amy Winehouse, Elton John, plus The Script and Will I Am. And we've actually got a quote of the show from our guest, Shelley F. Knight herself, and she doesn't know I was going to do this. So we hope that you're enjoying listening to our shows. The last show we focused on perfectionism, and interestingly, I had a new client recently who was exhausted and practically disabling herself by trying to be perfect. So it's definitely a thing. It's a thing that we are hearing a lot of. And hopefully, if any of you are listening to this show and missed that one, I would recommend you have a listen if you fall into that trap. Remember, if you have missed any of the shows, you can subscribe to the Two Minds YouTube channel and you'll then get a notification of our new episodes. We've also got a blog, which is linked to each of the shows. So if you prefer to read the content of the show rather than listen, then you can do that too. And remember also that Wirral Wave is now on Alexa, but you do need to launch Wirral Wave first and then play Wirral Wave. So hopefully you can do that too. Okay, so as I've said, for this show, we are going to look at the wider context of loss, and not just loss of a loved one. So loss is a natural part of life. And when grief is fresh, you probably don't even want to talk about it. But as the weeks and months go by, we start processing different aspects of the loss. Sometimes that's by talking to other people, sometimes seeing a therapist, or simply reading loss quotes or books that help you feel inspired and give you a new perspective and some level of comfort. But loss can take many forms. As we've said, obviously, the obvious type is a loved one or a pet that passes away. But maybe you might lose a job or a home and you need to work on perseverance. Or maybe your relationship has ended and you need to be able to process the situation. However loss appears in your life, it is important to remember that you're not alone. And while there is no quick fix, finding ways to heal and recover is vital. It is very common to only think that loss is connected to the loss of a person. But we do need to think about the wider context. And as Shelley says, it is anything where we have an emotional connection to it. So a job, as we've said, a relationship, body shape, your health, your wealth, confidence. And I think that's something that I really think we should remember, is we can lose our confidence, which does still form a part of grief. We can lose our safety, we can lose our purpose. And there's lots and lots of other ways that we can do that. So many of us may be living unknowingly with grief, and that is valid. What we can pay attention to is what we can learn from the change in our life through the loss, or we can work out what we could do to be different, to be able to recover. But one of the first places that we need to start is self-compassion and self-care. So that's going to be the sort of main theme of the show, how we can overcome that. But let's get the music going. And we have chosen a really powerful tune called Hallelujah. I think it's such a powerful tune, but certainly one to sit back and enjoy. So we're going to play Hallelujah by Alexandra Burke. I hope you enjoy it.
Heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do ya? When it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. Was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew ya. She tied you to her kitchen chair, she broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew.
Welcome back. We are now going to listen to my interview with Shelley F Knight, and we're going to do that earlier in the show than normal, as it gives so much for us to think about in terms of loss, and I think it's going to be really helpful. Shelley is so honest about her own life and how she has experienced loss, and hopefully what she has to say will resonate with many of you and help you so that you don't feel alone. Let's have a listen now and see some of the great advice that she has. I hope you find it helpful. So I am privileged to be joined again by Shelley F Knight. She was with us a few months ago now, and I've managed to get her back for a chat about her other book that she's going to tell us all about. Hi, Shelley.
Hi. Bless you. Thanks for having me back on the show. Yeah, so last time I spoke about Positive Changes, a self-kick book, which is my first book, which is quite humorous. But my second book, very long title, I can only apologise, is Good Grief, the A to Z Approach of Modern Day Grief Healing. And it's not humorous at all. And it's kind of a journey because my background's nursing, and then I become very spiritual later in life. And so it talks about grief, but probably not in a way that people expect. So it does deal with grief, as in death of a loved one. But I think that grief is loss of anything with which we have an emotional connection. So that could be our body shape, our health, a job, a relationship. And I think it's really important to talk about this because obviously we went through the pandemic, and in that we lost sort of confidence, control, health, security, jobs, finances, you name it, we lost it. You know, and it impacted on our mental health. And I truly believe it triggered a grief process in all of us, but we didn't identify it. So yeah, I wrote Good Grief during the pandemic. And then here we are with lots of us struggling with our mental health.
Oh, I love that. I love the idea of really thinking about loss in a almost in a quite a unique way, really. And it sounds crazy, but we don't pause to think about losing other things, do we? I mean, a lot of people talk about relationships, intimate relationships, but actually you're right, we can lose so much of ourselves through different experiences that we have.
Yeah, we truly do. And you know, we have this real mentality, don't we, here in the UK, just like, you know, oh well, wasn't meant to be, carry on, chin up. And you're like, you know, you're heartbroken, or at least heart bruised, I think. You know, you might, you know, identify with your job role, and you've lost that job during the pandemic. You think, who am I? You know, even like becoming a mum, you kind of lose your identity as well as your body, if you think, like, I went through. But you know, we're always experiencing loss. In Good Grief, the book, I talk about mini deaths. So it's where no one's died, but we're losing things in our life and having to find that resilience, that ability to bounce back. And we just don't give enough time to grieve, think, what on earth is going on? How do I overcome it? You know, and I think that just then impacts even more onto our mental health. We think, we don't think you're grieving, do you? If you know, your boyfriend leaves you or you lose a job, you don't think of it as a grief thing.
No, and I think that's the problem. We don't pause enough, do we? We are on to the next thing. You know, I can experience that myself. I used to be able to just brush myself down and think, okay. And then something that happened to me personally was I then had a loss that almost grounded me, because I think my unconscious mind said, oh, why are you here? There's all these other things that you've never, ever dealt with. And I'm a really big fan now of really getting people to just pause after something has changed in their lives, so that they can reflect, learn the good stuff, because even when something horrible happens, there's usually something that we can take as a positive, although occasionally they can be difficult to find.
Yeah, and I love that you shared that, because there is like a secondary loss. And I'm a great believer that when we go through something traumatic in life, that there's like, you know, an emotional memory as well as like, you know, the physical and things like that. And so what happens, like we go through life, and it might seem really unrelated. Like for me, I've had numerous miscarriages. I speak quite openly about that. I've had like numerous miscarriages. And, you know, for years and years, I wanted a child and I didn't get that take home baby. And it's only when we was buying a dog, I kid you not, that we went to get a puppy and the man sold it to someone else. So I didn't get that puppy to come home. And it triggered so many of my miscarriages. And it doesn't make sense on the outside, I know, But because the energy was the same within me, the emotions that were coming up were the same. I was a mess over a cockapoo puppy. I kid you not. And it is because we don't deal with things at the time. You know, I was getting older, so we kept trying for children, wasn't dealing with the miscarriages. And, you know, it's when we went to buy a dog later in life that all of that muck come up, all of those sticky plasters ripped off, because we don't stop. And we're so focused, aren't we, on healing. You know, you go through something, quick heal, deal with it. There's so much richness in the trauma, in that sort of hurt. And we just, you know, skip to the end, jolly hockey sticks and all that. And actually, in that pain and rawness, that's where the learning comes. But, you know, we have to sit there, and it's not very comfortable. But yeah, I'd encourage people to sit there for a while.
Yeah, me too. And I know that some people have said that too. Sit with you, sit with your yuck. They often look at me like I'm, you know, I'm losing it. But it is, there is so much wealth of our growth in those times, isn't there? But thank you so much for just sharing that, Shelley. I know that's a personal story, and I know it is something that you do share a lot, but it's still nice for you to still say it, because I'm sure when some people hear that, they can just hold themselves a bit tighter and know that it's okay to be not okay in these situations.
Yeah, and I see it a lot that people go through something and they think they're going mad. I mean, grief can make you feel like you're going mad anyway. But I think, oh, why am I crying so much over this? You know, and like another example is that my husband's friend's father died, was at his funeral, and I could not stop crying at all. You know, and he was a lovely man, but I didn't know him for the amount of tears I was shedding. But then I realized that when my own beautiful stepdad died, I was told, like, don't cry, let's just get through the service. And I pushed it all down, which you should never do. And it took, like, you know, and someone else to lose their dad, and then all those tears come up. So, you know, if you are bereft over something like losing a job, losing health, you know, something like that, just look back, you know, go down a little timeline, make a little rough timeline and think, where's this coming from? What's coming up for me? When did I last feel this emotion? And, you know, dive on in. Or yeah, just go in the water if it's a bit too much.
Oh, I love that. And I love the fact that you are open to saying to people, you know, it's going to feel uncomfortable, but know that if you sit with it and kind of look after yourself, reach out to others, you're not alone. We often are all having some sort of experience similar to this.
Yeah, I truly believe, you can phone in if you don't agree, but I truly believe that everyone is going through something that we don't know something about. So I think even those that are just handing their way through life today, there'll be something that's coming up, you know, like worrying about a bill to pay. Did I phone that person? And so, you know, reach out to others. I think you'd be really surprised.
Yeah, I think I often hear that with when I do group coaching in teams, or when even one-to-one, where people often are like this conversation, and you can literally hear that moment of, oh, I'm not the only one that's struggling with this. And definitely, like I said, in teams, I hear this a lot, where you bring people together and suddenly they realise that their colleague is actually struggling in the same kind of way or with a similar problem. And just sharing that load is half the battle.
Yeah, it truly is. There's an old saying, but, you know, I was raised in the 70s, Alison, but isn't it like a problem shared is a problem halved? And yeah, it's really like the truth to that, because even when you talk about something, even if that person doesn't understand or empathise with you, you do, you know, feel lighter. And I've shared before, slightly controversial, but my background was chemotherapy nursing. And so when you sit there giving the chemotherapy on a one-to-one, particularly with the breast cancer patients, it's kind of like a captive audience, because you've got to sit there administering these cytotoxic drugs. And they would talk to me about their life. You know, they're actually stopping for once and delving in. And they would say afterwards, oh, I'm so glad I got that off my chest. And you think, it just fascinates me that it was all the emotions that would come up on these breast cancer ladies getting things off their chest. And so I'd always say, get it out, because I do believe, you know, things can manifest when we don't get them out.
I think so. And I think all that, you know, that sort of when people have sore throats and that connection with not speaking up and not saying their truth also is just so powerful, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah,
brilliant. Oh, I've loved chatting with you again. What would be your little one thing that someone could take away today, if there's one small thing that they would take from you as a little nugget?
So it's 24 hours in the day, and I know we're really busy, I know that, but I would always say, that to commit to 10 minutes of you time every single day. And that's not 10 minutes on your phone scrolling through social media. It's a time of no distractions, just sitting with that kind of discomfort, like, what did I like about today? What's coming up for me in my grief? You know, just sitting in silence if you can, with no distractions, and you'll feel, well, just weird probably would be the first thing that come up, just sitting there in silence, but bear with me. But just sit there and like, ask questions to the universe, ask questions to yourself and see what's coming up. Because we do push things down all the time, you know. We just get stuck, don't we? Like, you know, setting your alarm for the morning, going to work, coming home, doing the shopping, going to bed, repeat. So 10 minutes a day, whether you're living or not, just to sit with yourself and see, you know, is life where you want it to be? How are you doing today? Do I need help? 10 minutes every single day.
Yeah, I love that. And I think just like we said before, pausing and just giving yourself permission to do that. I was working with somebody the other day and the thought of her taking some time out literally was such a new experience for her, because she spends all of her time running around after everyone else and actually thinking of things that she thinks she needs to be doing. And clearly she's realizing that actually that's not making her feel happy and good. So I think just that 10 minutes, and like you said before, or maybe on a previous chat, you know, 24 hours, we can find 10 minutes. Even busy people can find that 10 minutes.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's kind of like limited belief if you can't, you know, like I'm a busy mum of four and I work full time and things like that. And it is hard, but I just do it at the end of the day when I'm in bed. I sit there. My 10 minutes is journaling, so just writing, like, and I'm not allowed to write down think negative. I have to write about what am I grateful for the day that's just passed, you know. And it's 10 minutes.
It's lovely.
Not a lot. I'd love an hour, really, if I'm honest, Alison, but you know, we'll take the 10 minutes.
You can build on it on some days, I suppose.
Yeah. Brilliant.
Oh, some brilliant tips for everyone, Shelley. Thank you so much, as usual, for your time and your energy. I love speaking to you, so thanks so much for coming on Making Sense.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. Pleasure as always.
Thank you for tuning in to Making Sense with Alison Blackler.
Shelley's great, isn't she? If any of you enjoyed what she had to say, remember there is another show earlier on in the year that she was our guest, and in there we talked about self-help and how you can kickstart yourself. But I love her way of explaining how grief and loss is for so many of us. And if you want to check out Shelley's book, it is called Good Grief, The A to Z Approach of Modern Day Grief Healing. So it's a great book full of tools and approaches to help you move forward in your loss. Okay, so I think it's time now for another tune, and we have chosen Hall of Fame by The Script and Will I Am. This is an inspiring song, and it reminds us that we can do the impossible if we put the hard work in and have a belief in ourselves. I hope you enjoy it.
Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk to God, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock.
Yeah.
You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you can find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And the world.
You can run the mile, you can walk straight through with a smile. You could be the hero, you can get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke.
Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. And you're never gonna know if you never even try.
Do it for your country, do it for your name.
Cause there's gonna be a day when you're
standing in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah. And the world.
be believers, be leaders, be astronauts, be champions, be truth seekers, be students, be teachers, be politicians, be preachers, be believers, be leaders, be astronauts, be champions.
Standing in the hall of fame, and the world's gonna know your name.
You can be the king, come hanging on your chest. You can be the general, you can be the ball. You can talk your jacket, banging on the top. You can be the chancellor, you can be the clock. You can move a mountain, you can break rocks. You can be a jester, don't wait for luck. Dedicate your jump and you can find your first step.
Hope you enjoyed that tune there by The Script. Remember, the goal when making any changes is to focus on one small thing at a time. We are not needing to do anything too dramatic and too big in terms of dealing with yourself, particularly when you are managing any kind of loss. As Shelley mentioned in her interview, we need to remember that we can experience grief from anything we have an emotional connection for. And I think it's helpful to highlight a few important points to help us cope with any loss. So let's think about a few ideas. One I think is important for us to remember is it won't feel like this forever. And I know that when you are experiencing loss, whether that's loss of a person or a relationship, it can feel like you are really stuck in that feeling. And the feeling doesn't change necessarily, but the being stuck bit is the bit that usually changes. Another point to remember is that you can handle it, even when you feel like you can't. You are experiencing, you are dealing, and you are moving forward all of the time. Something else that's important for us is to be gentle with yourself. It's so important to make sure that we take care. Self-love, self-care is so critical, particularly if you are feeling very unhappy or unsettled. Another point is to remember that your feelings are normal. It is normal to feel these emotional responses that we have. And finally, you are not alone. And that is one thing that I'm desperately always trying to remind ourselves. And quite often when I'm working with people, we are remembering that we are all in a similar situation, not necessarily the same. So let's have a little bit deeper into how we can deal with loss. And again, remember, we're thinking about loss of anything. So the first point is to acknowledge your pain. As we've said, it is fine to feel upset or unhappy, but not fighting with it and ourselves is really important. Number two is to accept that grief can trigger many different and unexpected emotions. This can often be a bit of a surprise or even a shock. When we experience a loss, and this can then trigger old, unresolved, often deep-rooted loss or grief. And I can give you a personal example of that. When I lost my horse, and my horse I had owned for 24 years, I was absolutely devastated. But what I noticed was the grief definitely presented itself because of lots and lots of different issues which I maybe hadn't resolved. So I was obviously devastated about losing my horse, and it was a change of my lifestyle, but I noticed the amount of things that were coming from my subconscious mind which needed resolved. And it was almost as if my mind was saying, well, while you're there, there's all these other things to deal with. And I've heard this from many of my clients too, and I feel it is important for us just to remember that this often can happen. So some loss happens and we can experience old loss and it can hit us from nowhere. So number three, I think it's important for us to remember and understand that your grieving process will be unique to you. No one person is the same, and we need to be careful that we listen to ourselves rather than thinking that we should be managing in a way that someone else does or tells us to. And again, people often have the best intentions, but they can upset us further by saying you should be over this by now. Number four is we do need to seek face-to-face support from people who care about you, people who can hold a safe space so that you can talk freely about how you feel and have your feelings honoured. And number five is to support yourself emotionally by taking care of yourself physically and emotionally and mentally. On this show, we often say that we need to put self-care higher up on the agenda, and when dealing with loss of any kind, this is an absolute must. There is often so much pressure to get over or deal with what is happening for you. And if you could see me, I'm doing little speech marks in the air when we're saying get over or deal with. But it is so important for you to do this in your own way and look after yourself. I often get asked, how long does it take to recover from a loss? And the answer to this is there is no real answer. There is no set timetable for grief. You may start to feel better in 6 or 8 weeks, but the whole process can last for months and years. You may start to feel better in small ways, and it will start to get easier as time goes on. You may start to notice that getting up in the morning is a little bit easier. And again, keeping in mind this can be any type of loss, as we've said before, or you may find that you've got a little bit more energy. But having said that, for some, months and years after loss, they still continue to feel sadness and grief, particularly when confronted with reminders of their life or that person. It's important to find healthy ways to cope with these waves of grief as part of the healing process. But one thing that we do need to pay attention to is to make sure that you don't get truly stuck and are not able to move forward. I've worked with clients who may have got divorced 20 years previously and were still struggling to accept the loss and move on. So we definitely want to get some space to explore those kind of blockages so that the loss is still not affecting and defining us many, many years after the event. So I think the big message there is take your time, make sure that you are looking after yourself in whatever way is important to you, but making sure that you don't get too stuck, speaking up and letting other people know is one way of doing it. Right, I think it's time for a tune. And we have chosen an inspirational tune from 1983 from the legend of an artist, Sir Elton John. I'm Still Standing. And this speaks about Elton's successful recovery from a broken past relationship. And here he tells his ex that he has moved on and he is better off without them. It's a good sing-along tune, so I hope you can enjoy this.
You can never know what it's like. Your blood like winter freezes just like ice. And there's a cold and lonely light that shines from you. You wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. And did you think this fool could never win? Well, look at me, I'm coming back again. I got a taste of love in a simple way. And if you need to know while I'm still standing, you just fade away. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. Picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm still standing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Once I never could have hoped to win, you're starting down the road leaving me again. The threats you made were meant to cut me down. And if my love was just a circus, you'd be a clown by now. Better than I ever did. Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time. Picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I hope you enjoyed that. I certainly loved a bit of Elton John. So I want to put a little bit more attention on something that was mentioned in my interview with Shelley. And it is the idea that we can gain our greatest learning or insights when we actually sit with an uncomfortable feeling. Often when we feel anxious or upset, even angry, our first inclination is often for relief, which usually consists of some sort of avoidance. And while this isn't wrong, we just need to pay attention to how often we do it. So we can distract ourselves with TV, with social media, games, food, alcohol and loads of other things. And while these all do have a role, we need to be careful that we may create new problems for ourselves and we are then avoiding potentially what might be our greatest learning. Or alternatively, we can be brave and sit with the feeling. And yes, just allow it. We can breathe into it. We need to give ourselves permission to feel the feeling. And with practice, we can often help be more accepting and it be then more comfortable in our reality. By resting in awareness, we stop fighting with the truth and the truth for you. And then we start to become open to possibilities. And sometimes that possibility is that we're just okay, or new ideas and insights might come. And then also you're then learning how to handle what you didn't like. So there's many insightful souls like Buddha and Eckhart Tolle and Ram Dass have all encouraged us to do this. And if you listen to any of their teaching, they're basically encouraging us to be in the present, to be in the now. And this means getting comfortable with whatever comes up. So your job is to not necessarily like it, but to be okay and be open and aware. And luckily, this becomes easier when you remind yourself that everything passes, the pleasant and the unpleasant. It is crucial to understand that the goal here is to not necessarily figure out why you're feeling what you're feeling, but to stay with the discomfort and to be curious. You may even want to actually cultivate some curiosity, asking yourselves little questions like, what is going on for me? Why is it that I'm feeling like this? And what is it that I'm feeling? Once you allow yourself to be with what is true for yourself in that now, then all sorts of good things can come up. It may be helpful to think of that the pain is being inevitable, though the suffering is an option. So again, I'm not saying it's not easy to do, but it's something for you to keep an eye on. By resisting the urge to rate your feelings or yourself as bad for having them, you will begin to know that peace then comes from acceptance and your discomfort will not morph into more suffering. So it's a hard thing to do, but let's think about how we do it and let's think some steps and little exercise that you can do to help yourself with some emotional freedom from whatever it is that you have noticed that you're stuck on, which possibly was a loss. And this is really common in relationships. And as we've said earlier, losing a person is different, although it can show up in a similar way. So let's have a think about some steps. So we need to consciously stop ourselves a few times a day to do an internal check. Just a pause, just to notice, no judgment, but what are you feeling? What is happening for you? Asking yourself, what am I feeling now? Then we can allow this feeling, and whether that's a physical feeling, an emotional feeling, but without trying to repress it or distract yourself from it. Then we stay with whatever comes up, especially if you don't like it. And I know some people look at me when I suggest this and they think I'm mad, but actually being able to just stay with it, even if you don't like it, usually means that something new will come up for you. If you can, try to label what you're experiencing. For example, you might have a tightness in your throat, you might have tension in your back, you might feel the tension in your jaw, your heart might be pounding. Whatever you notice, just see if you can notice that. then it's quite a good idea to name the emotion, but simply name it by observing it, very simply. So it could be sadness, it could be anger, it could be resentment, it could be anxiety, grief, whatever it is that you are noticing, give it a name. Then they say that you will breathe then into the area that you've noticed the discomfort and keep drawing your breath in and breath, nice big breath in until you start to feel more relaxed. And this is a practice that we need to constantly do. And a little exercise that I think is really powerful is one that's called four square breathing. And you might want to do this now if you can with me. So what often we need to do when we're trying to be present is give our minds a little job to do, but we're wanting to be more focused on our body and particularly our breath. Our breath is such a powerful tool that we have with us all of the time, and it's something that we need to use more often and use more often consciously. So the exercise is where we are doing, it's called four square breathing, and the idea is that you're giving your mind a little job to do, but you are focusing on your body and bringing yourself into the now. So four square breathing is where we picture in our mind's eye a square, or you might want to do it with a picture or a computer screen in front of you. And you hold your breath in, taking a big deep breath in and counting to four, and run your eyes across the top of your square. And then you hold for four, and you picture yourself running down the square. And then you breathe out for four, again going across the bottom of the square. And then you hold for four, going up the other side of the square. I hope that makes sense. You then keep doing that about three or four times for square breathing. It helps bring your attention into the now. It helps you breathe deep into your tummy, which usually helps your mind relax. And then you can maybe think about what else you need to be doing. So it's really important for us to pause and think about breathing and some sort of mindfulness meditation. And on our YouTube, we have a body scan meditation, which you might want to go and have a look at. It is for about 10 minutes and it helps you bring your attention into maybe all the main parts of your body. And again, just breathing into those parts of your body, noticing any tension and any buildup of anything that doesn't feel good. And again, that just gives us something that is more powerful than being in your head or in your high emotions of anxiety or sadness. And all these things are just small little tools that we can use to help ourselves in that moment feel much, much better. So we're going to have another tune, and I have chosen a tune by Simply Red called Sunrise. I think it very much is connected to Daryl Hall and John Oates. And this is, I think, just a really positive, lovely tune. It is about two people not being available to each other, but having that attraction that's really intense. So it's something that just kind of often helps us just pause and think about our life and ourselves. So I hope you enjoy this tune by Simply Red.
Helps me realize. online and mobile.
Alexa, play Wirral Wave.
Wirral Wave.
Okay, so I am going to give you a quote of the show, and we have chosen one from Shelley F. Knight's book, and her book is called Good Grief, The A to Z Approach of Modern Day Grief Living. And she says, the truth is that each day we might be letting go of a plan, a dream, an idea. It might be about a meeting a friend for lunch. It might be around losing a job, or perhaps you woke up ill. At any time, each of us is grieving something. So I think that quote just reminds us, doesn't it, that we are all experiencing all sorts of loss all day, a lot of days. Things get cancelled. We are not able to do certain things. Ending of relationships, ending of friendships, jobs, all sorts of things. And I think it's just making sure that we are mindful of that. And I think something that Shelley talked about in the interview was also about how we all experience the pandemic. And I think there are a lot of people and a lot of us all dealing with some level of loss at various times in our day or in our week. You may be dealing with something that you are noticing about yourself today. And I think it's really important that we just look after ourselves and be kind and reach out. And I think that's mainly Shelley's message. But if you want to read more about her ideas, then please do get a copy of her book or follow her on her socials. Okay, so the other thing I just want to remind you all, in case some of you haven't checked out A Path Travelled, either How to Make Sense of Your Life or the second one, How to Make Sense of Relationships, just want to remind you that you can get the first chapter of each of these books for free by going on to Two Minds website, two-minds.co.uk, so that you can see if this interests you and whether it will help you. Remember, you can also pick them up in various shops around the Wirral area or on Amazon. But do check out some of the free chapters on Two Minds. So the other thing I want to just give a little shout out to again is if you fancy coming along to a face-to-face workshop, which we are running with Anchor Haven in New Ferry, and it is called Create Your Mind Toolkit, and it's on the 23rd of August. Tickets are available through our website, or through our socials, I should say, or through Anchor Haven. And there is an Eventbrite also being created. There are limited spaces, and I know that quite a lot of the tickets have already been sold. So if someone is struggling, maybe they're new to self-development, new to self-help, this might be a great way of finding out a little bit more. And it's a really small group, as I said, which means it'll be very personal. So please do have a look into that if you fancy coming along and learning a little bit more about yourself. I will be bringing the books with me, which again is a different place for us to explore little aspects of the books. So I would love to see some of you there. You are listening to Making Sense on Wirral Wave Radio. Okay, so we've come to the end of another show. Thank you so much for listening in. Remember to message in with any questions or topics that you would like us to cover. You can email the show anytime on makingsense@wirralwave.co.uk, or you can contact us on our socials. Instagram is Alison2Minds, Facebook is 2MindsUK, and Twitter is @AlisonBlackler. So we would love to hear from you. You can contact us on any of those, or you can contact Wirral Wave, studio@wirralwave.co.uk, or Wirral Wave Facebook page also. Please remember to send in your requests. We love picking the tunes that have a great message, but would love to hear your suggestions. You just might come up with an absolute corker for the show, and we would love to hear that. But remember, the only rule is good lyrics and a good vibe. In our next show, we are going to focus on sensitive people and how they manage, and how it's not necessarily a bad thing as long as you know how to manage it. And we have a special guest, Peter Paul Parker, who is a meditation and Qigong coach. He's also a musician, and we're going to play one of his songs as part of the show. So that'll be a new experience. I want to thank so much to Shelley F Knight for sharing her thoughts with us and giving us a fresh outlook on how to manage loss. We hope you've enjoyed this show. We have loved creating it for you. As ever, I want to thank George for all his production of the show. Thank you also to the Wirral Wave team for this opportunity. And most importantly, thank you to you for listening in. Please remember to tell your friends about Wirral Wave Radio. It is a community radio and it is growing. Check out all the other shows during the week. There is a jam-packed schedule and probably something for everyone's tastes. Remember, there are no adverts, no weather, no traffic, no news. So please do share Wirral Wave and make it a really good place to get some interesting conversations and obviously some great tunes. We will leave you with a great tune and I think a powerful message. It is by the wonderful Amy Winehouse. What a waste of a talented lady. And her not being able to deal with the loss of relationships and much of her life probably was a part of her demise. So we're going to end this show with Tears Dry on Their Own by Amy Winehouse. Myself and George will be back with a new episode in 2 weeks' time. In the meantime, be kind to yourself. Bye for now.
All I can ever be to you is the darkness that we know and this regret I got accustomed to. Once it was the ride when we were at our height, waiting for you in the hotel at night. I knew I had him at my match, but every moment we get snatched. I don't know why I got so attached. It's my responsibility. You don't own nothing to me but to walk away. I have no capacity. He walks away, the sun goes down. He takes the day, but I'm grown. And in your way, in this blue shade, my tears dry on their own. I don't understand, why do I stress the man when there's so many bigger things at hand? We could have never had it all. We had to hit a wall. So this is inevitable withdrawal. Even if I stop wanting you and perspective for shit's true, I'll be some next man's other woman. So I can't upgrade myself again. Should just be my own best friend. I put myself in the head with stupid man. He walks away. The sun goes down. I could say no regrets and no most of no day. Cause as we kiss goodbye, the sun sets. So we are history. The shadow covers me. The sky above the blaze. Lonely lovers see. He walks away. The sun goes down.
You're like a circle that floats around me, keeping me safe and sound. And when I fall, you've tied a rope to me. You're blessing me every day. I was down with an illusion, like a sparrow with broken wings, but now I shine with your reflection on me. I'm getting back up on my feet.